so much. Good morning, everyone. So essentially, this work it's about online device learning. Essentially, we know that by applying backpropagation to learn machine learning tasks, essentially, there is a larger disproportion between the memory required for inference and running the training. And in the last years, efforts have been made to simplify the model. However, still, while there is a little improvement on model footprint, then there was no significant improvement in terms of memory, RAM memory required to support the learning based on backpropagation. And there are reasons. I'm not bringing here the equations, but there are mathematical reasons why backpropagation requires a lot of memory, but also backpropagation is not plausible from a biological point of view, because the way the human brain learns is not well known, but essentially it's based on loops, and there is no weight symmetry like in backpropagation. There is no freeze of activities, no locality of the loss function, and no update locking as far as the weights, the model weights are concerned. So we need to investigate more modern methods that achieve forward learning and leave forever the backpropagation, even if we know that it is quite accurate. If we support continuous learning, then there is a change in the distribution of the classes, and this is typically cause catastrophic forgetting. So there is a boundary which between the classes that will be moved due to the new distribution of the features that will be proposed in time-varying fashion, and this has catastrophic implications. So the question we posed in this paper was if we can support multi-class without backpropagation to support continuous learning in order to avoid catastrophic forgetting, but deploy the workload, the learning, on tiny resource devices, such as microcontroller and potentially sensors. So the requirements, we want to support forward learning in real time without backpropagation, deployable on microcontroller and sensors. Microcontroller, especially sensor, feature very low amount of memory, few kilobytes. So these are the constraints. This is a huge constraint. Support multi-classification, interleave inference and learning and inference, minimize the memory footprint for a reason I said, and also decrease the computational complexity and so the inference latency. For that, we focus our attention on ML Commons Tiny Benchmark, which are industry supported benchmark for keyword spotting and image classification, respectively supported by depth separable CNN with softmax, trained with 36 epochs, and ResNet V1 with 500 epochs, and the claimed accuracy is 90%, top 185%. So what is RC? RC essentially is an hyperspherical classifier well known, where features essentially are used by to let the classifier learn. The classifier is the restrict column energy classifier. So every time a feature in red is sampled, then an hypersphere is associated to it. This is a kind of Disney representation projection in 2D. So another feature is sent to the classifier in forward fashion. Then if this falls in the region of influence, that's correctly classified. And so the hypersphere is kept as it is. Otherwise, it is, for example, in the baseline implementation halved in order to sample properly the feature space. And these go on and on for all the features, in this case, three classes, until all the features, all the feature space is sampled by hyperspheres. And there are proper boundaries between them. So what are the contributions that we brought here? First, we changed completely the learning paradigm. First of all, class by class, which means keyword one, learn, test, keyword two, learn, test, and so on and so forth. 20%, very minimal amount of data to support the learning, and mostly the data are used for the testing. So 20, 80%, vice versa than the typical 8, 20, 9, 10, 70, 30 that is used for back propagation. Feature extractor, tiny RC, which is the contribution. And the second contribution is that we associated to the hypersphere an aging score and the reliability score that allows us to prune hypersphere which are redundant, like this one. And only the most important one are kept. Otherwise, there is an overpopulation of hypersphere. These are the distribution of the feature for KWS and image classification using the two feature extractors, so the ResNet V1 and the DSCNN. And essentially, there is you see that in on image classification. Exactly, in image classification, the distribution is quite noisy. These may imply a lot of outliers as far as the tiny RC is concerned. But then what we did is to allow a graceful reduction thanks to different ways in order to decrease the size of the hypersphere. And also, if there are outliers which are meant as noise, these will not influence the hypersphere geometry reduction. Then the algorithm suffered by also another problem, which is known as last class problem, last thickest toll. Essentially, what happened is that class by class, there is a proper sampling of the feature space, but then the last class tend to create hypersphere that overwhelm all the feature space, and this create poor performances. And therefore, by applying an anti-overlapping technology that we developed, we made sure that the last class doesn't overwhelm the feature space, as in this example. Then for the image classification only, we applied also Bayesian hyperparameter optimization on the ratio, the pruning threshold, the train test split ratio, the function for the graceful degradation of the radius of the hypersphere and the weights in order to tune these hyperparameters. Then complexity profiling, we moved on microcontrollers, the U5, the STM32 U5 and 7, which are the opposite in terms of power consumption, 19 microampere per megahertz, 900 microampere per megahertz, so two different guys, and essentially we used the developer cloud, which is at this link, in order to profile automatically the complexity and cross-checking with unmade formulas also the complexity, considering various parameters like the number of neurons in the hidden layer of the 10ERC, the number of multiply and accumulation for every operation in the softmax, and the dimensionality used for the feature extractor. These are the main results. Essentially, let's start to consider the blue one. So we have the keyword spotting and the image classification. That's the feature extractor taken from the performance benchmark plus the proposed TinyRC versus the softmax. With the new proposed training procedure, essentially, we gained 3% over the claimant performance by ML Commons with a totally different training procedure. But if we apply to the softmax one epoch procedure, like in continuous learning, because essentially there are no epochs here, the performances are completely destroyed. And we still are on par, even better than with 36 epochs in continual learning versus the softmax. However, if we scramble the test set, so randomically shuffling the classes, the performances are still robust in case of 10ERC, are destroyed in the case of the softmax. There is a marginal gain for image classification, but still, again. Then we go to the complexity. As far as the complexity of the 10ERC versus the softmax with 36 epochs, essentially, we save 90% of the multiply and accumulate. There is the same footprint in terms of RAM, flash, and in terms of inference, the latency is essentially the equivalent. However, you may note that the feature extractor, and I will comment later, dominate the complexity. That's for KWS, then for image classification, essentially same comment, but there is a 400% increment in term of multiply and accumulate for 10 years C. These are marking million of operations. So you see once again that the feature extractor dominate. So let me recap. Essentially, 10ERC has been conceived in order to support on-device learning in incremental fashion. Then it has been cross-checked against ML Commons Tiny, which is an industry benchmark. We picked up two, there are four. The other two are essentially still audio and image. So we took the most complex one. First of all, TinyRC bring the advantage to learn from very few samples and is totally independent from the epochs. You have to understand that backpropagation with the epochs introduce an unknown factor, which is what is the right amount of epochs to conclude the learning, especially if you implement on the device. That's creating variability, which is not acceptable for real-time application. Then the memory footprint is on par with respect to the softmax. However, for keyword spotting, we saved 95% and we paid one order of magnitude more for inference. For image classification, we pay 400% in terms of MAC for training and two order of magnitude more for inference. In terms of accuracy, I just say that the gain with respect to ML Commons claimed is 3.67%. However, there is a concern, which is the complexity of the feature extractor. So what are the proposed development for the future? Is depart completely from pre-trained feature or any training procedure for feature extractor and go to extreme learning machines. Extreme learning machines are convolutional neural network where weights are initialized accordingly to a certain probability distribution of the weights. The real point are not the weights, but what is the best topology in order to create features that are robust enough in order to be classified and keep performances. For tiny devices, we need to depart from floating point and go to very low bit depth, even binary in some cases, and extend to new for heterogeneous sensors, the techniques. Thanks for your attention, and any question, please.